Amen.
You may be seated for a moment.
What a great song to start with this morning. The Lord Almighty reigns, the light of the world that we celebrated yesterday is coming, and now we can gather together today and celebrate He is here as the light. He's worthy of our worship, and we get together today to do that. So welcome. Thank you for carving your way through the snow this morning and getting here that we can be together. We love to receive these welcome cards. It helps us to connect with you and pray for you. If you're online, welcome to you as well. We're glad that you are here, and all the information you need is on our website for things that are coming up. Hope that you received a handout this morning with some important announcements of things that are coming, including the sermon notes for today and the passage that we'll be looking at. And today we are celebrating with communion. And if you're online, anytime now would be a great time to gather some elements that you can join with us in this time of remembering. If you did not receive one of these, there's a little basket next to that black box right there that you can grab at any time during worship so that we can celebrate communion together. Today our theme is worship. This light of the world was born as the King, and He is worthy of our worship, and that's our theme today. And one of the things that we get to do is give. Giving is a part of our worship, that we can give our best to Him. And so if you haven't heard the announcement yet at this point, we are today, anything that is given to the Outpost Church, anything that is put in that black box over there, or anything that is given online today, we're going to give it away. Part of it we're going to give to local ministries, to local missions. One of the ideas we're praying through is maybe creating a community benevolence fund that other churches in the community can participate in as well, to help to meet the needs of people in our community when a benevolence need comes up. So that's one idea. The other thing is we get to participate in, you know, we're the Christian and Missionary Alliance, which means we're a part of a family that's much bigger than just ourselves. We're a part of a global mission. We're celebrating participation in what God is doing around the world, which is a tremendous offering, a tremendous opportunity to give an offering to what they're calling the year-end offering, to help send some new missionaries this year to some very difficult places. Even as we think about the theme of worship, that is connected with missions. John Piper said that missions exists because worship doesn't. So today we get to give towards something global and help in what God is doing, help to fund what God is doing around the world and gathering together worshipers in a kingdom that is written about in Revelations, where one day we will be standing with every tribe and tongue and nation celebrating and worshiping Jesus. And we get to take part in that. So watch this little video clip that might prompt your heart a bit.
Hey friends, I'm here to invite you to participate again this Christmas in the Alliance's year-end offering. I'm coming to you from our Marketplace Ministries gathering, someplace warm, where I've heard incredible stories this week of God's work around the world. I wish you could hear a lot of the stories, but frankly, most of the ones that we've heard are in difficult, sometimes dangerous places. It's one of the hallmarks of Alliance missions that many organizations send folks, maybe 1 out of 100, to those least reached places, but in the Alliance, almost 80% of our workers are on the front lines. This Christmas, we celebrate Jesus. Our vision statement is all of Jesus for all the world. And the reason we even have all of Jesus is because light came into darkness, a baby was born. But the all the world part is a mandate to us, to the church. And as we partner together, we take all of Jesus, all of Him, all His healing power, the gospel to the ends of the earth. As always, when you give to the year-end offering, you are creating gospel access. You are the front edge of missions. When you give, you plant churches, you send workers, you see people come to faith. So this Christmas, as you consider where you're gonna spend and where you're gonna give, I wanna invite you to create gospel access in those least reached places so that we can live out our vision statement, all of Jesus for all the world.
Amen. All of Jesus for all the world. We're part of that. I want to encourage you to stand as we continue to worship this morning and hear these words from Psalm 26, verse 12. My feet stand on level ground. We stand on level ground because Jesus is here and he is the rock. My feet stand on level ground and the great congregation I will praise the Lord. Father, thank you that we can be in this place this morning together. Thank you that we can worship you. Thank you that you are a God who is worthy of our worship. Would you take these next moments and release our hearts and our minds and our souls and our voices to sing our praise to you, or shout our praise to you and say our praise to you, just celebrating the fact that you came to be our King, to save us and rescue us that we might follow you for all of eternity. We thank you for your presence with us. In Jesus' name, amen. Worship. So when I say that word, what comes to mind? What floods into your heart and mind when I say the word worship? You know, it's a very important word in the Bible. I like what A.W. Tozer said about worship. He defined it as, worship is the response of the inner man, the inner person, to the reality of who God is and what he has done. So worship is a faith response. And so we want to look into that word today. And we're not talking about worship as something just that we do on Sunday mornings. We're talking about worship as a lifestyle. So Matthew 2:2, we just had this section of scripture read for us. These magi say this, where is he who has been born King of the Jews? For we saw his star when it rose and have come to worship him. Now, note first of all their question, where it starts with, where is the King of the Jews? And if you've ever read the Gospel of Matthew, the book of Matthew, that really taps into the entire theme of the Gospel of Matthew, the King and his kingdom. And if you've read the book of Matthew before, perhaps your mind has already done a fast-forward thing and you've thought about what it says at the end of the book of Matthew, in Matthew 26:37, a scene at the cross where it's written, and over his head they put the charge against him, which read, this is Jesus, King of the Jews. What kind of a king would leave the throne of heaven and enter into our world in order to go to a cross to die for our sins and rise again from the dead so that we can have life? What kind of a king would leave heaven and come here to us and do what he did? The shameful, suffering death on a cross? A king worthy of our worship. A king who deserves our worship. A king who we can worship knowing that he has our best interest in mind. This is a king who loves us with an incredible love. And the invitation is for us to worship him. So what does that look like? As we work our way through this story in Matthew's gospel, consider some principles about worship that I think will encourage us today on this day after Christmas. And here's the first main thing that I think we should draw out of this story, is that worship begins with a search for Jesus. You know, some people start their search for truth and discover that Jesus is the truth, as is expressed in John 14:6, where Jesus said, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Some people start their search for truth and discover Jesus. Some people start their search for connection with God and discover that Jesus is the one that is a friend that's closer, sticks closer than a brother. Some people start with a search to remove the guilt from their own sin and the things of the darkness of their own lives and discover that Jesus came as the Savior. Some people search for a purpose, a direction that's bigger than themselves and discover that Jesus is the way. And he has an incredible mission and purpose that's bigger than ourselves, that's worth giving our lives for and worth giving our lives to. He gives us purpose and meaning. And whatever it is that sparks our journey, whatever it is that ignites the search, whatever initiates the pursuit, whatever lack in our lives launches the quest, every want, every need, and every desire will lead to Jesus. If it's an honest search, if we're truthful about it, it will take us to Jesus, where we discover he is the way and the truth and the life, and he is a king worthy of our worship. So these Magi, they say in Matthew 2:2, where is he? So they're on this search. And I think the most important thing we could say about their search and ours is that it is initiated by God. I mean, God put the star in the sky for them to follow. God put the desire in their hearts to find him. And he does the same for us. You know, one of my favorite books that I read that was given to me early in my journey with Jesus is called The Pursuit of God, which is written by A.W. Tozer. And Tozer, the principle of the book is that if we're searching for God, if we're, you know, hungry for God, if we're in pursuit of God, it's only because he first pursued us. And that was a very humbling thought for me when I first thought that through. And an incredible blessing to know that, wow, my hunger for God, my desire to get closer to God is because he put that desire there. He cares about me enough. He initiated it. He's reaching out to me, and I can love because he first loved me. That was true for the Magi. They're searching because God initiated it, as our search is initiated by him. Now, these Magi, a little bit of their background that I think will help us to understand their pursuit, their search for this Jesus. It's probably a couple years later that the Magi showed up. He's already in a home, and that's written about in 2:16. The Magi, they have become known traditionally, historically, as the wise men, or as kings from the East. But we don't know necessarily that they were kings, nor that they were all men. There were some scholars think there were probably some women in their midst, because there were Magi in that part of the world that were women. So there was this mix of people that were on this search. You know, it's mentioned that there's three gifts, but not necessarily three people. But these three gifts were brought for these from these Magi to give to the child. And their search was rooted in prophecy. It's really rooted in prophecy. Matthew 2:6 is a quote of Micah 5:2, which really shows that this was God's plan all along. None of this was an accident. It didn't just happen. God planned this from the beginning of time for these Magi even to be invited into the search for King Jesus, to worship, to find him and to worship him. They were interested. The Magi were historically interested in dreams and astrology and magic and books related to the future. And their interest in all of that took them on a search for Jesus. You know, our hope as a church family, you know, this is kind of an I have a dream kind of thing for us at the Outpost Church. I really hope and pray, and I think we already are in this kind of positioning of ourselves as a church body. I just long and hope that we are more and more a place where people end up here in our midst because they're searching for Jesus. Or because they're searching for truth and discover that Jesus is. Or that they're searching for relationship and connection and discover that Jesus is the author of all of that, and he is the greatest connection that we could have. That whatever people in our community in Trinity County are searching for, that we would be a welcoming family, that is a fun family to belong to come in and continue to grow as we encourage each other in the pursuit of Jesus, to worship him with all of our lives, that we would help each other go deeper, that people even that need healing would come and discover that Jesus is the healer, that people that need salvation would come and discover that Jesus is the Savior, that the one who offers all that we need is in our midst and working in our church body. And so we're an open place where we're real, honest. We're people that are transparent with each other. And we're not just doing this some kind of religious thing. We're just not going through the motions. This is a group of real, genuine, honest people who take off the masks and show the world that, hey, we just believe that the solution is Jesus for all my problems and all of our problems, and we're on this journey together, and we invite you in. An honest, real, transparent community where we come to the place where we worship Jesus as the one who sets us free to worship in spirit and in truth. But there's something else to note in this story that I think it's important for us to have on our radar and for us to have in mind. Choosing to worship Jesus might, maybe I should change the words to this. Choosing to worship Jesus will create a disturbance. Notice in Matthew 2:3, when King Herod heard this question of the Magi wanting to worship Jesus, did you catch that he was disturbed? He was troubled. You may have already discovered this as a follower of Jesus. Choosing to worship Jesus as part of your lifestyle, not just coming to a church service, but living out your love for Jesus in your daily life. When you choose to do that, to be a worshiper of Jesus as part of who you are, you might create some trouble for yourself. In fact, some of you already have. When we choose to follow Jesus and worship Jesus with our life, there are some people who will not like us. They won't like our convictions. They won't like what we stand for because they don't like Jesus as the King. King Herod, he was more into worship of himself than he was of anything else. And everyone worships something or someone. Everybody does. They might not understand that or realize that, but everybody worships something. King Herod was, you know, he kind of demonstrates he's worshiping himself. He didn't want to hear about another king. He was only interested in him being the king. And hearing of another king unsettled him, disturbed him, disrupted what he had in place. Him and all Jerusalem with him, his fear-based leadership generated into the community. And others also were afraid because the king, King Herod, was afraid of this king that's being declared. Notice the chief priests and the teachers in this story, that they also missed it because they were more interested in worship of their teachings and their traditions and their interpretations of the scriptures. And so they missed it too. When people get interrupted by the news of Jesus, there's a disturbance in the heart that can create all kinds of bad fruit. King Herod, did you notice what he said in verse 8? Hey, when you find him, report to me so I too can go worship him. Well, if you read the rest of the story, you discover that was a lie. That was a farce. He had absolutely no intention of worshiping and bowing down to King Jesus. And for you and your walk with Jesus, sometimes people might be a little perturbed and upset, and they may lie to you and pretend like they're interested, and all kinds of things can happen. It's because of that lack of connection with Jesus. And so we pray for them and we live this out. We live as worshipers of the King, and we don't want to intentionally weird people away, and we don't want to intentionally push people away further from Jesus by the things that we do. But oh, may we be worshipers of the King who tear down strongholds and every pretension that sets itself up against the knowledge of God, and take captive every thought and bring it into captivity to Christ Jesus, our Lord. Bring it into obedience to him and show that Jesus is our King and him alone we worship with all of our lives. May we be worshipers who disturb the darkness with light. Oh, may we be worshipers who remove the ceiling from anything that is trying to close us in. May we be worshipers who interrupt and disrupt the status quo. May we be worshipers who are serious about Jesus is my Lord, Jesus is my King. May we be worshipers who walk in a way that we turn on lights in the darkness. May we be true worshipers of the King that declare, we're all in. It's all about you, Jesus, and we give our all to you. Oh, that would come out of the way we live our lives in a way that's winsome and inviting and shows others that because we're worshipers of the King, we have the things that we've talked about this Christmas season. We have hope. We have love, true love. We have joy. We have peace that passes understanding. We have the love of Jesus in our lives. And we're willing to give our all to his control. He's the King. He's the Lord. That's another really important thing that I think comes out of this story of these Magi. Worship is marked. Worship is characterized by gratitude, by being people of gratitude, and that fuels more joyful giving. We love to give because we're so grateful for what God provided. Matthew chapter 2, verse 11. Let me read verse 11 for us again, just to remind us of what was going on as a part of their worship. On coming to the house, they saw the child with his mother Mary, and they bowed down and worshipped him. And they opened their treasures and presented him with gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Giving was a part of their worship. And in that, they found even deeper joy, peace, and all that they needed in Christ. These Magi went to great lengths and personal sacrifice to find Jesus and to worship him and give him these gifts that were really important gifts. And most of you in the room have experienced this as well. The joy of giving of ourselves, the blessing it is to give of ourselves to others. Generosity. And that takes us to a deeper place of joy as we live out of generous hearts that are willing to give. You know, what if our culture, what if the culture around us was less about entitlement and more about generosity? What if we as a church family could model that? I think we are. I mean, we could make a significant difference. We could change the shift of our culture by living this out. We're generous people. We're giving people because God is such an incredibly generous God. And we do this as an act of worship. Giving of ourselves and our time and our treasures and our talents is just part of who we are as a way to say, God, you're the king and we're all in and we give it all to you, to your control. And we're grateful for all that you provide. These Magi, they brought these three gifts, expensive gifts, that really point to the valuable treasure that Jesus is. And the king that is worthy of our worship, gold, which really is a symbol of kingship, royalty. This frankincense, which really symbolizes holiness in worship. And gifts for a deity. Myrrh, which is prophetic, really, because that was used in embalming and anointing a body and preparing it for burial. So there's this component of prophetic in our worship and in our giving of ourselves. And the point of all of it, the point of all the gifts and all the worship that's going on with these Magi, and the point is, it all points to Jesus as the King worthy of our worship. And this King Jesus made himself approachable and relational in coming at Christmas into the most humble place. And he walks with us and he talks with us. So this is another really important part of this story that I think we can zero in on this morning, that worship, when we choose to be worshipers of the King, when we choose to worship King Jesus, it really opens the door for us to grow in our relationship with him and listen to his voice. Worship opens a door for God's voice in our lives. They worshiped Jesus. They gave gifts fit for a king. And in their worship, sometimes we hear the voice of God in our worship. Sometimes we hear the voice of God in a profound way after we've been in a season of worship. For them, worship opened up, they opened up the treasures of, they presented their gifts and they followed God's voice in this dream that was given to them. And they were warned not to go back to Herod, and they returned to their country by another route, by another way. A new adventure for them. I mean, if you track this story of the Magi, and their whole journey was really about a new adventure, charting new territory to search for king, for the king, and then go and proclaim to others. They tried this new journey home, this different way to go home, initiated and told to them by God. You know, next week, you know, we're entering into the new year. And a new year, we all kind of think in terms of, you know, should I make some resolutions or should... At the very least, I think there's a desire deep within every one of our hearts to have an opportunity for something new, something fresh, like a new start. I just want to encourage all of us in our journey with Jesus to think about that in a very real way in our faith journey, to try something new and fresh in our walk with him. We're starting Genesis next week, If you haven't already done so, I would encourage you to grab this study book that many of us are going to use to help in this journey and to launch us into a deeper walk with Him. I just encourage you to try something new in your approach to even reading Scripture this year. There's some tools on the welcome table. Some of you like to read the Bible on your cell phones or your iPad or whatever, you know, the new Blue Letter Bible or the YouVersion app. They have programs that launches you into a daily journey of reading through the Bible. Try something new. I'm really hoping and praying that all of us together as a church family can think outside of the box and think of fresh approaches to living out our faith, and especially how we get into God's Word and get deeper in it. Because there's a profound sense in which the Bible is the voice of God to us. He speaks to us in it and through it. So if you're going through Genesis, you know, you've probably already noticed in this book, some of you are already into this and almost done with it, I think, some of you. You'll notice that there's discussion questions in here. The best way to approach this is to do the activities that are in here and do the discussion questions with someone else, with another person, or be involved in a group. And by the way, we're starting a new group. Chris and I are going to start a new small group starting January 5th, Wednesday nights. We're going to get together and we're going to go through Genesis together. If you'd like to be a part of that, just let us know. We're inviting people now. If you're not a part of some kind of a group and you want to be, just let me know. We'd love to invite you in to that, to take this journey with us as we move into this new year. Now, in this, some of you have already tried this too. What's described in here is what is called SOAP, S-O-A-P. Let me describe that for a minute, because some of you have seen this and thought, what? You've never seen this before. Others have said, oh yeah, and it's reemerging from you've seen it in the past and you've used it and you're getting back to it. I want to encourage you to really think about at least trying this model of SOAP. It's just like a pattern for how to get into my Bible and to really dive deeper in it and apply it to my life. So that the S stands for Scripture. So as you're reading through a Scripture passage, maybe you're doing a daily reading through the Bible in some kind of a journey, and some verse might, you know, jump off the page at you. It's like, oh, that's kind of significant. You know, we know that when that happens, that's usually for me, that's almost always the Holy Spirit saying, hey, tune in to these words. Because it's God's Word. It's His words to us. And so when you have those moments where something just grabs your heart, tune into that. And then what you can do is write down that Scripture. That's what the S is. Identify what is that Scripture. Sometimes it's a verse. Sometimes it's several verses. Sometimes it's a whole passage. And you just write that down and note it. Because it's phenomenal the way God can speak to us through His Word. He really does speak to us through His Word. And He gives us, as we study His Word and live in His Word and get our hearts into it, He gives us so many reasons to worship Him. And He gives us so many words to use in our worship of Him. So think about it. Here's the thing. This book is from God. It's God's Word to us. It's living and active. It's real and it's powerful. Why not try when a verse in the Bible jumps out at you to write it down and to think a little more deeply about it? So first identify what that Scripture is as you're reading through your Bible, and then make some observations about it. Just some general observations. If you read in the book, there's some prompting questions there that help with that. You know, what does this passage as I'm reading it teach me about God? What's it teach about me? What's it reveal about my heart? What promises are in there? What warnings might there be? What is something new that you're learning as you read this? What are examples that you can follow? What are questions that emerge? What are things that maybe you'd want to dive deeper into and think about and maybe get out some commentaries and Bible dictionaries and study a little more deeply? What questions come out? What stands out at you? What is repeated in this chapter of the Bible if it's repeated a number of times, it must be important. What are those kind of observations that you can make? Now, to be honest, many of you have already done those first two parts. You've identified a Scripture and you've made observations. And if you're an intellectual type, sometimes we can spend all of our time just on the observations and dig deeper and get, what is the meaning of this? And what's the background of this? And what is all this? And we can write a whole page of our observations about this passage. But then here comes the hard part. The A stands for application. Scripture, observations, what do I see? What is God saying in this passage? Applications. This is, for many of us on many days, the most important things for us as personal individuals following Jesus. Because this is the, so what? Okay, I've learned all these things. I've made all these observations. God, what are you saying in this moment to me? And for many of us, this is the hardest part. Taking what we've discovered and applying it. God, what is it that you want me to do? What is it that you want me to hear and apply to my own life in this? What is the thing that you want me to obey as a way to say I love you? And write those things down. Because a posture of obedience and trying to tune into applying God's word to my life is an expression of worship that really opens the door for God to speak to us and guide us even more. The wise men did. They listened to God's voice. They obeyed. They went. They applied it. They did what God had encouraged them to do. So scripture, observation, application, and then just a short prayer is what I do. I do this often in my own journey with Jesus in my devotional life. And I often look back on these entries. That I can just about guarantee you, if you will at least try this, and try to write some things down. Even if you don't want to, maybe this is not appealing to you, maybe you've got another system that works just fine for you. Whatever that is, try it. And I can guarantee you, because it's been so true in my life, that later, down the road, you'll be picking up this book and breezing through it and seeing the prayer that you wrote. And, oh, I remember that moment. I remember what God was speaking into my life. I remember what God is doing, and it offers to us a tremendous blessing that is also a moment of worship. Thank you, God, that back there I was struggling with this, and you've gotten me through it. You've given me victory in it. And it is a profound source of blessing if we take it seriously. Because as we read our Bibles and pray and worship with an open Bible, it helps us to tune in to God's profound voice and direction in our lives. And that helps us to worship him even more. Let me wrap this up and close with a story that might help you to bring it together, brought it together for me. I'm a hunter. I enjoy hunting. And we lived in Montana for quite a while, and I enjoy elk hunting. And my son and I, Coulter, were out on an elk hunt in the fall in this particular time. And it was during the season of the year where elk bugle. And if you have no idea what I'm talking about, well, if you've ever heard my cell phone, the ringtone is an elk bugle. You can Google it. What's an elk bugle? And listen to it. If you've never heard it, I happen to think it is the most profound, awesome, amazing sound in all of nature. You know, next to hearing the angels sing like they did on Christmas Day, that would be pretty awesome. But just what we experience in nature right now, I just think an elk bugle is just such an amazing sound. It's that noise that a bull elk makes when, you know, they've got their herd that time of year, and some other elk is looking to gather a herd, and they'll offer these challenges to each other. So if you learn how to imitate an elk bugle, you can draw them in to where you are. You can find out where they are by listening and get closer to them by imitating that call, that bugle. So on this particular morning, my son and I got out before the sun was up, and we were out there just listening to see if any of the bulls were bugling. It was that time of year, and we heard one bugle. And we thought, oh, this is it. So we moved closer to him. We walked in that direction. Didn't hear him for a while, so we paused, and we gave out a bugle, to which we got a response that was closer than it was before. And if, you know, maybe you can relate to this story. I don't know if you can. It gets my heart. It gets the heart pumping. It's like, oh, we're getting closer. And you just get this imagination going. It's like, oh, this is like a 7x7 bull elk that's just massive and incredible. It's going to be a trophy. So we would bugle, and he would bugle. We'd move a little closer, and we'd hear him bugle. And we bugle, we're getting closer and closer, and finally we got out onto this ridge where we could see this whole area where this elk was. We knew he was right there. And the last time we had heard him bugle, we just knew he was right there in that patch of timber. And any moment, we're going to see the movement. We're going to see the antlers. We're just going to be amazed. It's like, I hope we can steady our hands enough to fire off a shot. But this bull, this massive bull elk trophy is moving closer and closer. We know he's right there, and we're watching. And we see movement, and it's another hunter. The other hunters in the room are like, ah. Maybe you've done that? So we had this moment. He was far enough away that we weren't sure we had eye contact, but it felt like we had eye contact. I think he saw us, and we saw him for sure. And we did this thing that's kind of an unwritten code in Montana. You know, when something like that happens, you just kind of look the other way, and you walk away from it and pretend it never happened. Because it's so embarrassing. You know, you spent all this time following that noise, following that voice, following that sound, just getting excited about getting closer and closer to it, and then discover it wasn't even the real thing. It was a counterfeit. It was something entirely different that we poured our energy into to search for. Can you relate? I can think of so many times in my life where I've searched in the wrong places, gone the wrong direction, tuned into the wrong voice, and to discover that it was all a waste of time and it was just a counterfeit. It wasn't the real thing. If we're honest about pursuing Jesus and searching for Jesus and listening for his voice, he helps us through his word to make sure we don't get distracted by the many other voices and noises in our world, that we can stay tuned into him. And that can only happen, honestly, if we really are people who believe in this book, that it's his word. And he guides us through it, and he gives us direction, and he speaks to us in it. So a couple applications that I hope will help you to stir your heart a little deeper in some of this and apply it to your own life. Let me just ask it, what is it that you're searching for? You know, be honest with yourself. What is it today that you're really searching for? And think that through. If this search for this, whatever you're searching for, is not taking you toward Jesus, it's going to end up as a counterfeit, fake, not satisfying. Nothing is going to stir the heart unless it's taking you toward Jesus. So think that through. Maybe think about that this week. What are you searching for? And is it taking you closer to Jesus? Another question you might think about this week, what are you discovering about worship? Because Jesus really is. He said, I am seeking worshipers. The Father is seeking worshipers who will worship him in spirit and in truth. God is seeking worshipers. He's seeking to draw in worshipers into his kingdom. So what are you learning about what that looks like in your own life? And what might you adjust in this new year to go deeper in it? And let me just encourage you to at least once try the soap. Try getting into your word. And even if you're not a writer, you just despise writing, you hate to write, maybe you want to make a recording, do something that will jot down your thoughts as you read the Word of God. Because as we pray and worship with an open Bible, it helps us to keep our search aimed in the right direction toward Jesus. And as we read our Word and pray and worship with an open Bible, it gives us courage when people around us might be getting unsettled and unraveled. And reading our Bibles and worshiping and praying with our Bibles open helps us to become more and more people of gratitude. And prayer and worship with an open Bible keeps us tuned in to God's incredible voice. So I want to invite us to tune into his voice right now. And if you have your elements with you, one side has the bread. And I would just encourage you to rip off the cover of this and open up this treasure, this treasured memory. Tune into this as God's voice for us today. Jesus said in Luke 22:19, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Would you pray with me before we take of it? And then we'll all take together. It's just kind of a fun thing to do in unity, communion in unity. Lord, we remember today. Yesterday we remembered the cradle. Today we remember the cross and the resurrection that makes tomorrow possible. Worshiping you, the King, forever. I encourage you to grab onto your bread and just hold that for a moment. Jesus, you, the bread of life, you were laid in a wooden food trough for animals. You, the bread of life, you're back against a wooden manger because you were going to go to a wooden cross. You laid down your life there. God, in this moment, we ask you to forgive us for the things that we have done, the things that we have said, the things that we have failed to do, the things that we have thought that were wrong. God, would you forgive us for the things that have separated us from you? Forgive us for searching in the wrong places. Forgive us, Father, for anything that is not pleasing to you. We just take a moment right now and ask you to forgive us. And God, in this moment, we thank you. The forgiveness was made possible because of what you did at the cross. We want to be people of gratitude that live our lives as a thank you note to you, that live our lives in worship of you, the King, who came to make it possible for us to be forgiven and free. Thank you for what you did at the cross. We remember the cost. We remember your love. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's take together. And on that night long ago, Jesus took a cup. And he said, "This is my blood, the new covenant, shed for you, for the forgiveness of sins." God, we remember, we thank you that you died on a cross, a shameful, horrible, suffering death because of your love for us. And then you rose again from the tomb that we can follow you into life. You conquered it all by your death and resurrection. And your invitation is for us to follow you, to believe in you, to trust in you, to worship you. And so in this moment, we remember the cost. And yet we remember the incredible intensity of your love. Thank you that we can be free to worship you and to live our lives in worship unto you. And we look forward to that day when we'll be in the kingdom with people from every tribe and tongue and nation, declaring that you are the Lamb who was slain. You are the King of the universe. We worship you, Jesus. We thank you for this moment and the life you bring in these moments. In Jesus' name, let's take together. to sing with. I can anticipate this week being down in Ace Hardware, and that song breaks out. Whoa, 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 whoa. That song is like, what are you doing? It's like, oh, sorry, I just, you know, I had a moment of song we had on Sunday, and I was worshiping Jesus in the moment. Sorry to interrupt your world and disturb it. God is good. Let's go forth and let our lives sing to his glory. Can you guys play that again so we can sing it on our way out? Amen. Yeah.